Less is more? Not today. My name is Ian Martin Allison for SBL, and today I want to talk to you about the pioneers of the octave string bass. 8-string, 12-string, there have been a lot of players that have used these instruments to great effect. And while I know this looks like gratuitous bass nerdery right here, I can assure you that it is born out of song service. So today I want to take you through my favorite performances by octave string bass players and bands throughout the years. But first, I gotta talk to you a little bit about gear. The 8-string bass as a concept was born way before the 12-string bass in the 60s, but today I am using my 1980 Ibanez ST980 8-string. The 12-string bass didn't come around until the late 70s, and I believe Hamer was the first manufacturer to do a 12, and today I am playing my 1993 Hamer Chaparral 12. So what's the deal with how these are tuned? Well, of course, you can tune them any way you want. The typical way to tune an 8-string bass is, of course, you have E, A, D, and G, and then you have higher octave strings that are just literally tuned one octave higher, like in guitar register, E, A, D, G, similar to a 12-string guitar concept. So when you play it, you get both octaves at the same time. In the spirit of more is more, if there's an 8-string bass, why not a 12? In the late 70s, Tom Peterson of Cheap Trick teamed up with Joel Danzig of Hamer Guitars and made the very first 12-string bass, the Hamer Quad. The 12-string just expands on the 8-string idea by adding an additional octave string to the group. So now instead of just having one bass string and one string an octave higher, you have one bass string and two strings that are tuned in unison an octave higher. And you may have the same reaction that I did when I first heard about this. Why? Well, check it out. Because you can never actually get all three strings exactly in tune, you get this wide, sort of chorusy sound with each note that you play. And if you put a little drive on, things just get more rock and roll. So for outboard gear today, I am running through my Origin Cali 76 and into a preset that I have created for this video. I have the option of turning on a drive first, followed by an Ampeg SVT amp and cab sim, and then just a touch of room reverb to put the sound in a space. First up is John Paul Jones from Led Zeppelin's 1976 record, Presence, playing his Alembic 8-string on Achilles' Last Stand. Ah. Listen to JPJ gallop, then play a chord here. This first track is the perfect example of why an octave string bass can be so cool in a rock context. If you think about Zeppelin, they're essentially just a three-piece rock band where you've got bass, drums, and guitar, and then a frontman that doesn't play an instrument. And while of course Jimmy Page can overdub in the studio, sometimes when a guitar player goes up high and then the bottom is just filled out down low, there's a mid-range character missing. Enter the 8-string bass. So right at the top of the tune, JPJ is demonstrating two very cool concepts that an octave string bass can do. He's using a galloping rhythm on the E, which almost sounds like a bass and a guitar together. And then after the riff, he plays a D chord over his low E. But instead of playing the D here, he goes up and plays it in a first inversion. What does that mean, Ian? It just means that he's starting with the F sharp, which is the third, and then playing the fifth, which is A, playing them together over the low E. Now, next up is the man of the hour, Mr. Tom Peterson from Cheap Trick, who, with Joel Danzig, dreamed up the idea and put into production the Hamer quad 12-string bass. And I found a great video of Tom playing the super rad rock and roll intro of Gonna Raise Hell with his pointy Hamer 12 quad. Oh! See how it sort of feels like a guitar and a bass at the same time? That sound, check that out. Like, if you played that on a regular four-string bass, it would not have the same rock and roll grind and impact, right? It sounds so massive on a 12. I just kicked on a little bit of drive and I'm playing, of course, with a pick. Here, what I'm doing is I'm playing the C and then also just putting down a G, and it just becomes a power chord. But it's six strings playing the C and the G notes together. So it's just huge. Next up is Chris Squire from Yes, who is of course most known for a Rickenbacker, but used a Rainy eight string on the 1983 record 90125. You got these prog rock dudes like Chris Squire, right? Trying to move things forward with rock and roll. And instead of using it as an octave string bass, he decided to tune the high strings in fifths. So now I have to tune.
One eternity later.
Check out Squire when he enters here with this odd time synth figure. It sounds like a guitar and a bass together, a fifth apart, like playing power chords, but it's just because he has his bass tuned in fifths. Check that figure out. Next up is probably my favorite octave string bass player of all time, Mr. Doug Pinnick from King's X, playing on the 1989 record, Gretchen Goes to Nebraska, This Is Over My Head. The spin, the pants, the mohawk, the left-handed bass, and he's the singer. I love Doug Pinnick so much, and just listen to how this instrument in a three-piece rock band supports in a guitar solo. Doug is one of the best to ever do this. Playing those fifths. Here's a little known fact. Jason Newsted from Metallica actually played a 12 on Wherever I May Roam from the 1991 Black Album. Okay, now there's a little debate on whether it's the sound at the top of the tune. That low sound. Or whether it's the crack when the drums come in. And I think it's the crack with a bunch of reverb. So this is such a fun thing to do. I've got a cave reverb that I'm dialing up. So now this is going from being a bass to being a Foley instrument, almost like a tool that you would use to create a certain sound effect. Just the rake of the strings with a bunch of reverb on it. I mean, that is so much fun. All I'm doing, right, is I have a big giant reverb on back here, and I'm just using the pick with an upstroke, And I've got to say, since I learned about this, I have been using this on records. I'll send overdubs where I'm playing something with a copious amount of reverb to almost emulate cymbals or like a swell, because if you reverse it, it can swell into a transition. Next up is probably the most famous example of a 12-string bass on a recording. This is from Pearl Jam's 1991 debut release 10. This is Jeff Ament playing his Hamer 12 on Jeremy. The harmonics. So to get this sound, I pulled the amp emulation off and I turned on just a bit of long reverb. And this intro is just so cool. Then there's those harmonics. So this whole thing is based around the open A string and then a hammer-on from D to E. It's just this. Open A, hammer-on from D to E, back to the open A, and then A, open A, G. And the chime of the 12 string just ringing. Now the harmonics were done as an overdub in the studio, but if you want to incorporate them into the riff, try this. Saying to yourself, Ian, this is all fine and good, but I'm not gonna buy a 12-string bass. Is there any way that I could emulate this sound on a 4-string? Check it out. I put a block in the HX stomp called dual pitch, where you have the dry signal and then I have two other pitches. Now, I set both of those to octave up and then detuned each one slightly and time adjusted each one slightly so that all three notes are slightly out of tune and all hit at slightly different times. It's not perfect, it's not a 12, but it's kind of cool. Let's check out my 12-string bass emulation song over Big Rex, That Song, featuring the amazing bass playing of Mr. Dave Henning, who when I first saw in concert was playing a big Hamer Shap 12, and he was playing it so hard that a bunch of the octave strings had busted and were hanging off the headstock, and it was so rock and roll. Now, if you're like, hold on, Ian, all of these effects, all of these bass lines whizzing by, how will I remember? You're in luck, because the amazing team at SBL put together a PDF workbook for you featuring all of the transcriptions of these tunes and how to think about crafting some of these sounds even if you don't have an HX stomp. And we are gonna finish up today with where we started, JPJ Bookends. John Paul Jones put out The Thunder Thief in 2001, featuring a ton of amazing 8 and 12 string bass playing. Here's a title track, check it out. Here we go. Check this riff out. Okay, we gotta check that out. Let me slow that down and play it for you. Here we go. A lot of bouncing off of open strings with this stuff, right? Flat, bouncing to that open A. Yeah. But hold up. JPJ isn't done. In 2009, he teamed up with Dave Grohl of the Foo Fighters and Josh Homme from Queens of the Stone Age to create the project Them Crooked Vultures. Check out Gunman. Oh! Oh, there's so much to love about this. He starts out with that cool chord figure. It's a D minor chord ending with a flat five. Starts with the natural fifth, A, F, D, then the flat five, A flat. Oh, it's ominous. What a great way. And then we get. And then the monster riff. What a fun riff to play! I had so much fun making this video. I have loved these instruments for a lot of years. Is it the right thing for everyone? Of course not. Is it super rad? Of course. I have been Ian Martin Allison. We'll see you in the next one.